In the second half of the 19th century, Gregor Mendel had worked out the basic laws of heredity with pea plants. At the same time, Charles Darwin had observed the larger process of evolution in birds and tortoises. But what about people? What these insights meant for the human race was the next frontier. At the turn of the century, in London, a cousin of Darwin's named Francis Galton, a brilliant scientist in his own right, asked himself a provocative question. If farmers could breed better cattle, why couldn't an enlightened society breed a better human being? What nature does blindly and slowly, he wrote, man may do providently and quickly.
This was an age of science, an age of reason. Darwin was using scientific principles to look at the world and figure out the world. And Galton was taking these same scientific ideas and saying, how can we actually work with the human race and perfect it?
Galton became the father of a new pseudoscience that would shadow genetics across the 20th century. It was called eugenics.
Eugenics basically means good genesis, good inheritance. And that's what Galton is interested in. Science can solve problems. Gonna make the planet a better place. And eugenics was part of that. No longer are we sort of being buffeted through history by the forces of evolution. We're gonna take control.
Darwin was talking about adaptation to an environment. There were certain species, certain people within a species that adapted well or didn't adapt, but it comes to us through eugenics as here are the fit people and they're the ones we want, and here are the inferiors, the unfit, and we need to get rid of them. It was a perversion, but it fit into their view of the world.
Galton's vision of the steady improvement of the human race attracted many leading thinkers in England, from Winston Churchill to H.G. Wells, but never managed to spark a national movement.
Which nation on the planet really took eugenics to heart? It wasn't the Europeans. It was the can-do, solve-the-problem Americans.
In the early years of the 20th century, middle-class Americans felt threatened by a vast, uncontrolled influx of immigrants from Eastern and Southern Europe.
This idea of eugenics hits America at a time of great anxiety, a time when American society is in flux. And particularly for the old Anglo-Saxon middle class, they look around and the nation that they were born into is not.
Galton had called for those with talent to improve themselves by selective breeding. American eugenicists took his idea a step further. Those deemed inferior, the feeble-minded, promiscuous, or disabled should be stopped from having children altogether.
There's a real worry that it's not enough to breed the best, but to keep the national average up, you need to eliminate the worst, to cut off from the bottom the disease roots of the genetic tree.
While Congress imposed quotas to bar undesirable immigrants, 32 states passed compulsory sterilization laws for those deemed unfit. Some 64,000 Americans, most of them women, were legally sterilized, nearly all against their will, or without their knowledge. Enthusiasm for eugenics remained high among Americans until they saw another country take it to its logical and horrifying conclusion.